GoldenEye 007 on the Nintendo 64. How this came to light deserves a video on its own. The N64 was released in 1996 after numerous delays, and Nintendo had recently turned Rare into a second-party developer after purchasing a 49% stake. Rare saw the N64 as an opportunity to push boundaries and stand out from other developers in the gaming world. And looking back now, boy did they. Putting the Rare logo next to a Nintendo 64, it puts a smile on your face. Their standout title, which would end up becoming Banjo-Kazooie, was constantly delayed and had to release a lot of their side projects, including Blast Corps, Diddy Kong Racing, and GoldenEye 007. The movie GoldenEye was released in 1995. It was the first James Bond in 6 years, and it was considered an improvement over the past few Bond films. If you want my input, I say it's a good Bond movie, although the one-on-one car chase between an Aston Martin DB5 and Ferrari F355 is absurd. And like every Bond villain, Trevelyan is a buffoon for giving Bond so many chances to escape from trouble. But at its time, GoldenEye created a modern image of the James Bond franchise, and it was fun to watch. But anyway, because Nintendo decided they can appeal to an older demographic, I'm assuming thanks to the first Mortal Kombat, the rights to a video game adaptation were given to them. Because shooters were more popular outside of Japan, Nintendo gave the project to Rare. Now, movie-based video games are mostly known for being rushed to meet with the movie release date, like Star Trek, Iron Man, and E.T. Rare were guilty of the same thing, as they had a poor reputation when it came to movie-based titles including Beetlejuice, A Nightmare on Elm Street, and Who Framed Roger Rabbit, all on the NES. Each one, rubbish. But now, they're working exclusively for Nintendo. The Stamper Brothers put quality over quantity, and they wanted something astounding from a bunch of debut developers. But they were given the time they needed, even if the release date would be after the movie. Because of the success of Rare's very own Donkey Kong Country, their first original idea was to make GoldenEye a 2D side-scrolling shooter on the Super Nintendo using pre-rendered graphics, and tie the release date with the film. Picture that in your mind. But game director Martin Hollis decided to go 3D because the Nintendo 64 was around the corner. Their second idea was to make an on-rail shooter like Sega's Virtual Cop. Then later in development, they chose to give the player freedom of movement, which was pretty similar to id Software games like Doom and Quake, which were PC titles. Because the game took so long to develop with its ridiculous complexity, for a few months Nintendo just stopped funding the game because of its high glitch count and lack of progress. But Rare had faith in it, and GoldenEye would be released—
No wait, we forgot the multiplayer!
Okay, GoldenEye 007 on the N64 would be released in 1997, nearly 2 years after the movie, and a few months before the next Bond movie, Tomorrow Never Dies. James Bond is on a mission to stop criminal syndicates from using the satellite weapon against London to cause a global financial meltdown, the exact same plot as the film. I love how it stays as loyal to the source material as possible, from the levels, the music for the most part, the texted dialogue, and gadgets. When you pause the game, Bond looks at his watch to reach the menu. Genius. Even the cutscenes try to resemble the film itself, and for an early 3D game to do this, that's impressive. Despite this, the writers also tried to branch the story further. There's a 9-year gap between when Bond escapes the chemical weapons facility and racing Xenia Onatopp. Why not add more to the story? One mission, James Bond was sent to investigate the station where the GoldenEye is being controlled. I don't remember this from the movie. Game artist Carl Hilton said, "We tried to stick to the reference material for authenticity, but we weren't afraid of adding to it to help the game design. It was very organic." First-person shooters on consoles weren't popular at the time because D-pad control doesn't work as well as a mouse, and they had a lot more technical limitations than a PC. Because the Nintendo 64 was delayed, developers who were making games for the system had no idea what the system specs were, nor did they even have the real controller. The developers of GoldenEye were using Silicon Graphics Onyx computers that were more powerful than the actual console. They had to write the code, design the game based on what they thought the system specs would be on the N64, and on top of that, they were using a modified Sega Saturn controller for testing. But they had great ideas, and they weren't going to be discouraged by the lack of system knowledge. Each level involves completing different objectives like finding the forbidden GoldenEye or save hostages, as opposed to just killing enemies. But unlike Super Mario 64, you can't complete one objective and restart, you have to complete them all. The difficulty is well balanced. On Agent, there are less objectives to do and you take more damage. As the difficulty increases, there's more to do and you can even edit the damage settings. The gun is on the corner of the screen as opposed to being in front of you like in Quake. When you shoot an enemy, different body parts do certain damage, like shooting the head would instantly kill them while shooting the leg would just hurt them. The developers also created a guard detection system. Enemies would be alerted by gunfire if too many shots are fired, and if you shoot less with a silenced weapon, they won't detect you, adding stealth elements to a 007 video game. How appropriate. So, basically, you have the option to play the game like you're actually James Bond, or run at enemies like Arnold Schwarzenegger. Just remember to reload. Now, why am I explaining such basic features? Well, firstly, that's what it has, and secondly, and more importantly, it's because this game was the first to introduce all these features in the FPS genre. That's how revolutionary GoldenEye 007 is. Because this game was initially developed as an on-rail shooter, some of the level designs, Facility in particular, look like on-rail shooter levels. This was the moment when the team decided to experiment on free movement, and some of the gameplay features like reloading, the cost of shooting innocent people, and zooming in were inspired by Virtua Cop. This also meant some accessible rooms meant nothing. Game director Martin Hollis said, "The benefit of this sloppy, unplanned approach was that many of the levels in the game have a realistic and non-linear feel." He definitely wouldn't be thinking that now, I can tell you that much. We'll get to that. Another thing that enhances the experience is using cheats. I mean, the idea of a gold pistol that can shoot paintballs hard enough to kill. Sounds cool, right? How about two of them? How about blowing up enemies that are built like Donkey Kong with two rocket launchers? Once you beat the game, you'll have access to a couple of levels based on other Bond films like Moonraker and The Man with the Golden Gun. But to get the most enjoyment out of GoldenEye, make sure you have four working controllers, invite some friends over, and try out co-op multiplayer. Believe it or not, multiplayer was added only a few weeks before release and was considered an afterthought.
No, wait, we forgot the multiplayer!
It's a good job someone from the team afterthought it. The ability to play as different characters with random weapons scattered on 12 maps, even if they're just cutouts of the campaign levels, this was extremely fun and competitive at the same time. Need a reason why the Nintendo 64 is one of the greatest co-op multiplayer systems of all time? GoldenEye 007, that's all you need. Case closed. They were going to give you the ability to play as four different James Bonds, but it was scrapped by Nintendo to avoid lawsuits over the use of real people. But it's still in the game's code and it can be hacked. Also, the instruction manual has a snapshot of the four different Bonds as originally planned. Speaking of game hacking, in 2012, someone found out that if you hack this game, you'll find a ZX Spectrum emulator with games developed by Rare under the name Ultimate Play the Game, including Jetpack and Saberwolf. So that means to anyone who has a copy of GoldenEye 007 on the N64, you also have 10 ZX Spectrum games as well. It was an experiment by Rare to see if the Nintendo 64 can emulate ZX Spectrum games, and it was made inaccessible. I don't know why, it's their games, it's not like they're risking lawsuit because Jetpack was in Donkey Kong 64. GoldenEye was well ahead of its time. But, right now, taking off my nostalgic glasses, this has aged so much to the point that it might actually be dead. There are a ton of problems. First of all, the frame rate. It defies description. Is this meant to be the perspective of James Bond himself? Or maybe it's an STD he caught off one of the hundreds of women he banged and he seems to fatigue more quickly than usual. And how it looks. Granted, the buildings and surroundings relate immediately back to the film, but nobody can deny it has fallen victim to being an early 3D game. The enemy and friendly AI is laughable. Natalia is a huge liability, and even though soldiers can detect gunfire, they run around in circles like there's a spider in the room. Although it beats having a D-pad only, this doesn't use dual analog controls, so if you want to manually aim your gun, you have to stop. However, when aiming from the hip, it immediately locks on the enemy, even from a sniper distance, so all you have to do is look forward at the enemies and hold the trigger because the gun automatically aims for you, which feels boring after a few minutes. One thing that also doesn't help the controls is that the analog sticks on N64 controllers have worn out over the years. I know this sounds like blasphemy to most of you considering the enormous amount of praise it's gotten over the years, But that's what I'm trying to say. It's been years now, and first-person shooters have gone to the point where we consider GoldenEye 007 on the N64 inferior. You know it, I know it, even the game knows it. So think about that when you're complaining about games like Destiny, Evolve, Call of Duty, and Battlefield. Actually, in about 10 years' time, we'll say those are graphically inferior too. Even 6th generation masterpieces like GTA San Andreas are starting to show their age as well. We're just moving forward is all, and that's a good thing. Which is why I'm not going to rate it, because do you give it a high rating for its innovation, or a low one for being outdated beyond words I can even describe? What I'm trying to say is that you can't dispute its revolutionary features and being the life of parties with the multiplayer. But now we have much better games. It came out at a time when Doom, Quake, and Duke Nukem 3D were really the only FPSs out there. Now the genre has flooded the gaming industry along with quick access to reviews like this, so you're not short on choice. There was a Virtual Boy version of the game which was meant to be a racer, but it was scrapped because the system was a catastrophe. All in all, I think it was for the best, and besides, the N64 title sold over 8 million copies worldwide, becoming the third best-selling game on the Nintendo 64 behind Super Mario 64 and Mario Kart 64, and the best-selling in North America. This game is so popular, it led to many spiritual successes, spin-offs, and remakes. That's the power of GoldenEye for you.